CBM Day 12 Seminar and Exhibition on Condition-Based Maintenance Day Beyond Expectation.
นะคะเที่ยง40ค่ะถึงเวลาบ่าย2 40นาทีนะคะวันนี้ค่ะเราได้รับเกียรติจากดร.เซอร์เจ ดาจินนะคะ Burger Hills GE Company ค่ะวันนี้นะคะท่านจะมาแชร์ประสบการณ์เรื่องของการวัดการสั่นสะเทือนการบิดของเพลา The Thermal Vibration Measurement นะคะและกรณีศึกษา ODS ของปั๊มบนแท่นขุดเจาะน้ำมันค่ะเรียนเชิญค่ะ
Hello, the first question. Can you hear me well without mic? No? Okay, I'll use my mic. I am Dr. Sergey. And I am speaking behalf of General Electric Baker Hughes Company, and I will talk a little bit about myself, then some vibration theory, some boring things with formulas, but I try to minimize it, and then I'll present two case histories about a real story, how we can troubleshoot, how we done troubleshooting, and how we save customer machines. Okay. Let's start from the beginning. Many times I am starting my speech from simple question. Do you know who is diagnosed? The simple explanation is very, very easy to explain. First of all, if you are feeling bad, high temperature, some fever, what are you doing if you are feeling bad? No, you think, let's wait a couple days, maybe everything will be okay. But in a couple days, if situations became worse, what are you doing? No, not going to doctor, you're going to grandma to ask support. In few more days, if situations became worse and worse, you're going to expensive hospital to the diagnostic person to understand what's wrong with your body. The same for machines, for mechanism. Somebody, some experienced person should understand what's wrong with machines. Oh, something wrong with machines. One moment. Okay. And in worldwide, we have more than 140 machinery diagnostic engineers and 15 machinery diagnostic engineers covered Asia-Pacific region, so your region. It includes Australia, Japan, Thailand, Singapore, Malaysia, etc., etc. But some person should care about these engineers. Some person should train, should grow talents, and should control. And this person is technical leader, myself. So I am responsible for quality, I am responsible to grow the talents, and I am responsible for proper job execution. So if you will receive any machinery diagnostic report from my engineers, you will see my signature and I'll check all data in each report. To be honest, last year it was more than 600 reports. So you can imagine how good we are, I hope. Okay, so few words about myself. More than 22 years with vibration analysis, PhD, based on non-destructive control, vibration analysis, ultrasound control, thermovision, tribo diagnostic, etc., etc. So a lot. And mostly all 22 years with Bentley equipment and 12 plus years with Bentley Nevada as employee. So that's about myself. What's wrong? Excuse me, something wrong with presentation. Yes. But As I said, we have 140 machinery diagnostic engineers. So one tech lead cannot cover all world, and we have 10 tech leads for different region, for US, for Europe, for China, for Middle East. These guys are my colleagues, and they're doing the same or even better job to control, to support machinery diagnostic engineers. So, when we are talking about Bentley Nevada, when we are talking about Baker Hughes GE company, not a lone person came to site. Their cumulative experience, more than 1,000 years experience working for you. More than 140 heads thinking how to solve your problem, because we have experts at the different areas, and we can invite any person, let's say from US, from Europe, from Middle East, to solve your problem. So investigation is not job for one person. This is a big team job. When we are talking about services, I can say since 1978, we done more than 18,000 successful machinery diagnostic jobs. So we have big experience. Our cumulative experience is more than 1,000 years. So average plus minus 9 years per each person with data analysis. Of course, some got more experience. We have some fresh guys, but we have experienced person. We can provide reactive jobs. We can provide SSA. It means long-term agreement when we are looking for your machine, monitoring technical condition of machines. And we are not only doing such diagnostic job, but we are going to train customer to do this job. And we are supporting customer to do this job. So training is our business as well, to explain how to analyze data, how to identify any malfunctions. Okay, 53 training, technical trainings locations worldwide. Okay, when we are talking about machinery diagnostic job, about measurements, data analysis, of course we can talk about simple vibration, casing vibration, rotor vibration analysis, etc., etc. But this is only small part of job, because we can do much more. You can see additional to data analysis, we can do startup assistance. So you have new machine, you have machine before, after overhaul. Data should be analyzed, correct? For condition-based maintenance. Optimization job. If you have some software, any software should be ideal to collect data properly, to store data properly, so we can optimize our software to collect data according to your needs and according to diagnostic engineer's needs. Of course, balancing, I will not say a lot about balancing and alignment, but of course we can do it. Thermal grow calculations, no problem. Trainings already done. Some root cause analysis, no problem. That's our job, to understand what is the real machine faults, but not the sequence. Reciprocating machine diagnostic, we have special tools to analyze data, vibration process data from reciprocating machines, compressors, some special consulting calculations, rotor dynamic modeling, torsional analysis, of course, and today I'll talk a little bit about it. Structural testing, yes, of course. Active magnetic bearing diagnostic, why not? That's rotating machinery, why not? We can do it. And a lot more. So we are not limited with rigid frames, we can do more and more. And our expertise of our 140 engineers is very wide. And of course, based on customer request, we even can increase it. And we are increasing it based on our service every day. Okay, a few words about increasing our experience. First of all, if some engineer, doesn't matter, young or experienced engineer, came to our company, he should pass long certification, long training way. We have a lot of trainings for each engineer, starting from basic things, basic on operation, some transducers, machines, and one by one, person can select his way and to become the real machinery diagnostic engineer, it can take up to 10 years to get the experience, to pass all exam, all certification, all on-job trainings. So I can say even myself is not at the end of this way with more than 22 years of field job. So, but additionally to machinery diagnostic actions, we are training the instructors, internal instructors or instructors for customer to help customer to become real machinery diagnostic engineer, to do the same job as we are doing. So we can help, we can provide a lot of different trainings. And later I'll talk about it. When we are talking about equipment, mostly we are using the Bentley Nevada equipment. We are using the portable data collectors, multi-channel data collectors. We are using our software, which can connect it to our rack and took data and store it for ages. We can use some specific tools designed by us or designed by third party to analyze this data. Let's say balancing tool, why not? Time to time, again something wrong, one moment. Yes. We can use the third-party software to provide the rotor modeling for ODS, for impact test. We can use the Emiscope. We can collect data by our hardware and use third-party software for analysis because it's really brilliant software. We can use the different type of measurements, let's say for magnetic bearings. We can use not the position measurements but current measurements to analyze the rotor dynamics. We can do it. When we are talking about some advanced measurements, today I will talk about torsional vibration measurements. And we can use few data source to get the torsional vibration, torsional excitation, torsional response. And of course, we can calculate and we can present for customer what is the root cause, what is the real problem for that machine. Yes, when we are talking about torsional vibration data, we can use not only some temporary solution, but we can get data from permanently installed system. For now, this is a third-party torximeter system, but for now, we are at the process of certification, the new probe to measure the torsional vibration by our system. And shortly, this system will be issued and can be shipped. A few words about trainings. Experienced machinery diagnostic engineer in our company who certified as trainer can provide trainings for customer, and this training can start from basic vibration analysis, from hardware operation, till really complicated things like rotor modeling, structure testing, etc., etc. This example of advanced machinery dynamic course, and at that course we are talking about complicated machine malfunctions, and we are talking about rotor modeling, let's say structure testing, torsional vibration measurements, etc., etc. But again, step by step, we can grow machinery diagnostic engineer for us or for customer. That's just a few words about what I'm doing in company and what our company doing at the world. But now let's do two more practical things and just simple question on the screen. What does it mean malfunctions? Malfunctions is something bad, something abnormal at your machine, which can potentially destroy your machine or affect production, safety or something else. To be honest, it will affect money. So, our goal is to detect this malfunction. Our goal is to understand what is wrong in our equipment, in your machine. And mainly we will use the direct measurement, like vibration measurement, to get this information. But of course, vibration measurements is not enough. even when you are going to the doctor, doctor can provide a lot of different type of analysis. Blood pressure, blood chemical analysis, etc., etc. A lot of even the electrical impulses in your body. The same for any mechanical object. The different type of data can be used. We can measure overall vibration level, but this is only like traffic light, red, yellow, green. We can use some filtered vectors, we can use waveforms, synchronous, asynchronous, we can use two waveforms collected at the same time to build the orbit plot, we can build shaft center line position trend, plot inside your bearing clearance boundary, etc., etc. So all this data can be analyzed and then used for root cause analysis for real problem identification. Of course, when we are talking about our data, we need to collect data not only for steady state operation. Time to time, we are asking customer to play with load, to decrease load, to increase load. We need to collect data from transient data analysis for machine startup, for machine shutdown. Time to time, even data from stopped machine is really critical to analyze, just to have the, let's say, reference for shaft center line position for the stopped machine to understand how my shaft is floating inside the bearing clearance, for example. And the big advantages, for many machines, we have already installed system and the system is collecting data simultaneously. Let's say yesterday night, I got question, request from customer. Customer suspect rotor crack. And it is really big issue because to confirm this rotor crack, we need to open machine and provide non-destructive control. Or alternatively, we can open historical data for last couple years and compare few startups and shutdown and say, dear customer, don't worry, your shaft is pretty good because the resonance frequency is the same, slow roll is the same, etc., etc., damping stiffness. So historical data, properly collected historical data is pretty important. And of course, we are using it. If customer hasn't such system, of course, we can collect simultaneously data from whole machine by portable data analyzer. But again, this is only some snapshot for one day analysis, and it is not so good. So one step back. I have already mentioned the startup assistance. Maybe 1 year ago, we provide startup assistance for the same machine, and we have footprint, we have the historical reference data, which can be used as reference for comparison. Okay, that's about detection. But I like that picture because you have never seen such things in the world. Any solution should be based on measurements. So we should have a lot of measurements. We should analyze it. We should compare these measurements to create one brilliant solution. We cannot build measurements about machine condition based on one microphone data installed in the middle of the plant, for sure. So we should have a lot of props properly installed, properly configured props to get data, to filter it, to analyze it, and to create the proper solution. Okay, that was just some prerequisites from my speech. And now we will talk about some real machines, about real malfunctions. All this data is from real field, from real machinery diagnostic investigation. That story will be about combined cycle generator. You can see the gas turbine, generator, and steam turbine. And the problem was pretty simple. Customer realized the high vibration spikes at the bearing number 5. Bearing number 5 is... Bearing number 5 is steam turbine bearing, close to the coupling site here. Customer realized the high vibration spikes close to the trip signal. You can see vibration level is pretty high, up to 150 microns. peak to peak. And this vibration is at the startup and just beginning of the loading. Of course, customer is not happy with it because machine is heating, is operating time to time at the partial load, and customer requests us to analyze data. Of course, the first step to analyze data is the frequency-based analysis. Let's say spectrum. You can see some snapshot of waterfall, and to be honest, not so clear, because we have harmonical series and nothing more. If we will go to the ISO cores, level 2, level 3, level 4 cores, ISO can say maybe it is something looseness, maybe it is something else, but nothing clear, because that's not, let's say, the common malfunction. And another thing, you can see this is subsynchronous component, very low frequency component. So what we can do else, we can see the waveform, the shape of our vibration. Easily. You can see this is synchronous waveform for 150 milliseconds, for few shaft revolutions, we have one impulse. You can see it. One impulse. Of course, I would like to see the longer data, so I can open asynchronous waveform for more than 3 seconds. And you can see the periodical spikes. But again, frequency is pretty low, about 5 hertz. Much more lower as shaft rotation frequency. So now it is time to scratch the head and try to understand what can happen with my machine. Every 1/5 of 1 second, we have some spikes. And this is exactly mechanical issue, but something looks like some impulse. Okay, so what we can do, zoom it away from. Okay, we should think. And in this case, I would like to open the manual, the documentation for that machine, the data sheet, to analyze the existing data. And hopefully it was the GE machine, so we have access to all data. And when we open the data sheet, we can see the second calculated torsional natural frequency is exactly this 5 hertz. So for now, we have more idea. So we have some impact in torsional, in tangential direction. And we are talking about bearing close to the coupling. Yes, it is good idea now to inspect the coupling and understand what is the coupling design. And coupling design is pretty interesting because this is not rigid coupling. This is coupling with flexible element tor. But, this flexible element has additional gear in case of huge torque at the beginning of startup. This gear, this coupling is operating like gear coupling. So we can talk about non-linear stiffness during the startup and loading. And this non-linear stiffness, it means the distance cannot change more when our force is increasing, will generate for us self-excited vibration in torsional direction, in tangential direction, let's say, for that machine, for this coupling. So during startup, we have some impacts between tooth. Of course, now this is chicken and egg problem. What is the first? The rotor excitation or the torsional response, correct? Yes. And for now, even the simple, the speed trend can help us, because when we have two key phasers at the different sides of machine, we can see the speed fluctuation. Red and yellow line is a speed trend for steam turbine and gas turbine. So we have speed fluctuation from both sides of the rotor. Like this, correct? Okay, and now we should think about the source of this speed fluctuation. This is gas turbine and steam turbine. And here for this case, we can talk about some problem with control system, with speed controller, because it is some delay between reading and control system activation, and this delay is different for steam turbine and gas turbine. And now we have the different speed for different side of our machine. As result, we have two contact at the coupling, impact, non-linear stiffness, and self-excite torsional vibration. And of course, our rotor is absolutely happy to respond, to reply at his natural frequency. So the root cause for this problem was detected. This is the speed fluctuation. And now there is a task for OEM, for control guys, to minimize this speed difference between gas turbine and steam turbine, to synchronize it. Okay? But my question is pretty simple and pretty hard at the same time. Why torsional vibration is so dangerous, so important for us? I can say because, first of all our machines can experience torsional excitation, because this is just physical characteristics. Torsional resonance is the same physical characteristic as lateral resonance. Each equipment has it. The second thing, the torsional excitation is the sliding killer, because normally we cannot identify it very easy. For lateral vibration, it is pretty easy. We can measure shaft vibration, we can measure the casing vibration response, but for torsional vibration analysis, we should use the special tools to get this data. And these tools is not, first of all, the tools are not ideal, and second thing, it is pretty expensive and pretty complicated to use. So that's the sliding killer, and now we should understand how to measure that torsional excitation, the torsional rotor system response, how to analyze it. There are, let's say, few notifications in our IP standards about it, but let's go to the simple things. First of all, I'll show example of torsional vibration damage modes. You can see mostly it is cracks in spiral cracks. Why? Because during the tangential excitation, rotor tangential excitation, we have compression and tension at the different directions. So we are going to compress material in one direction and tension it at another direction. This tension and compression cycles are reason for this spiral cracks. Okay, you can see crankshaft, you can see some coupling sites, etc., etc. Another one is key points shaft case, because this is the weakest point. The stiffness of material there is much more lower. So that's the weakest points. And in case of torsional excitation, additional load, this point will be damaged exactly. So if you can see some spiral cracks, or if you can see some problem with shaft case, you should suspect one of the possible malfunctions is torsional excitation. But it's too late. Your machine already damaged. Of course, we should avoid it. Okay, that's the gear. Again, huge tangential forces between gears, or at the coupling, will be result of fatigue. Correct? So we should think how to understand this is torsional excitation, how to measure it. Just few boring formulas. Everybody knows the Newton law. Force is equal to mass multiplied to acceleration. Same for Euler law. If we are talking about not mass, but inertial mass and angular excitation, we will measure, we will understand what's how big is our torsional. And when we are talking about our rotor, the mass is constant. So all torsional excitation is proportional to the speed variation. To the acceleration, it means speed variation. So if we will measure the speed variation, acceleration of our rotor, we can estimate the torsional forces. Okay, so how we can measure the speed variation? We have, first of all, key phasor. We have one impulse per shaft revolution, and this impulse can be measured like this. Pulse, 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 pulse. So if we have the good system, this system will allow us to measure the time interval between these pulses. Yes, but we have some limitations because of physics. The Nyquist theory limits us with frequency. If my shaft is rotating, let's say 50 hertz, our limitation is 50 divided by 2, or a little bit more than 2, because of our computer system. So our frequency of interest will be limited about even less than 20 hertz. Mathematically 25, but in real life less than 20 hertz. And time to time, the natural frequency or frequency of our interest is higher. What we can do? We can increase number of the pulses per shaft revolution. How can we do it? Okay. How can we do it? We can increase number of the pulses by increasing number of the reference marks. We can use multi-event wheel, speed wheel, overspeed wheel to get, let's say, 20, 50 impulses per one shaft revolution. Or later I'll talk about zebra tape. It is a special tape which we can glue to the shaft, around the shaft, with black and white areas. So we can get more than one impulse per shaft revolution to calculate the higher and higher frequency. Because same as for lateral analysis, it can be first, second, third, fourth mode. And we should measure it and analyze it. Okay. And of course, we should collect this data. As we are talking about some high frequency, we need some system which can collect data and collect data with high quality. So for our system, we have some feature it calls raw data. So data with high frequency sampling rate. This frequency sample rate is 24 bits. It's about 128 kilohertz, more than enough, even from physics point of view. Okay, so we can collect data. Now, this is explanation how we are using this data. This case history is about J-box vibration. History is pretty simple. We got the J-box, pretty well equipped with proximity probe, with casing vibration probes, and the situation is really bad because the J-box shaft has high vibration. Of course, first of all, we saw this vibration and customers suspect the fluid-induced instability because it was low frequency vibration, less than half of the shaft revolution. And this vibration was at the certain moment when shaft was unloaded. Okay, you can see the spectrums, you can see the certain frequency, and at the some moment of speed up, when our shaft is floated, and where our shaft was located close to the center of the bearing, it was unloaded, poor damping. We can observe this low frequency vibration. Okay, good, but customers suspect the fluid-induced instability, but it is not true, because after data analysis, we detect this is the torsional mode of our shaft. Again, it can be tested, it can be detected from data sheet, etc., etc. And now we should understand the torsional vibration and fluid-induced instability, the two different things, two different ways how to solve it, correct? But the question was, why this vibration appeared here? Excitation was absolutely the same for all operation mode. But at this certain point, the rotor was unloaded. Unloaded, power dumped, so the bigger response. But torsional excitation, again, was for the all operation modes. So we need to solve this problem. And how we detected? We detected pretty easy. We used the speed pickup. We got the frequency and used the simple frequency modulation analyzer. This is our software which can detect this frequency modulation. So we can see exactly at this frequency around 9 Hz we have high peak of torsional vibration of That's about a J-box. Another one story about torsional vibration will be about more complicated machine. This is a turbine and generator. But we was happy to use this machine as a stand. So we have installed for that machine, of course, key phaser to have one pulse per revolution. We have glued the zebra tape. And we used two overspeed wheels, so we can get vibration, torsional vibration, speed variation data in four different planes. Good? I think so. Of course, we collect all this data using our system. We collect the high frequency sampling data and analyze it by our software. But in this case, we should think about few different limitations. First limitation is multi-event wheel, overspeed wheel. It should be already installed on machine. Not each machine got this overspeed wheel. But if you have it, okay, great. The second thing, this multi-event wheel is not ideal. The gears is not ideal. The tooth is not ideal. The tooth can be different shape, different distance between these two. So we should use the synchronous averaging to minimize these gear issues. Of course, we can use it and we can analyze this data. The second thing is zebra tape. We are using special zebra tape. It can be glued to the shaft and collect the signals, let's say 60 something pulses per shaft revolution. Of course, some limitations again, it should be installed, it should be glued properly without any problems. This is some example of installation. Nothing more. Of course, the learn of this shaft surface is not certain numbers, but let's say as designed. So we will have one bigger block, let's say white or black. Black block should be painted and we can use it as reference. So this additional feature, but again, we should compensate this glue area because one black block is a little bit bigger. So it can be done by software again. Of course, some explanation how to glue zebra tape properly, because it should be on shaft during our measurements. Example of probe installation, this is feature of laser speed pickup. It should be installed not so close to shaft, not exactly orthogonally to the shaft surface. Okay, and at result we can see such simple plot. Such simple plot is the detected speed variation. Of course, to get the excitation, the best idea is to play with speed, or if machine is not ideal, control it, it will be some speed variation, so it will be some excitation. You can see here the speed is dropping from 47 Hz to 46 Hz and then increase it. So we have some excitation. Good for us. We can test the natural frequency of torsional natural frequency. Okay, but you can see the speed is not linearly changing, but with some fluctuation. For now, by this software, we can filter this speed fluctuation like this, and you can see few degrees up and down, our shaft speed is fluctuating. So my shaft hasn't the continuous speed, but it reply based on his torsional natural frequency. Okay, and now this waveform can be averaged using the key phasor signal to provide the time synchronous averaging, and then we can provide the frequency analysis, and we can see certain natural frequencies for this shaft. Okay, if we have few different points to measure, we can see a little bit different data. Okay, you can see it for timing wheel, you can see it for zebra tape, you can see it for zebra tape again from multi-event wheel. Yes, you can see some additional frequencies, and these frequencies, as I already mentioned, it's because of gear issues, not ideal gear geometry. Correct? So we can filter it again, and we can compare few our results. But as I mentioned, result can be different. It is the same as our natural lateral resonances, natural frequencies for radial vibration, because it can be some nodal points, can be some antinodal points, and our rotor response can be totally different. Okay, let's imagine my shaft, my microphone will be the shaft. If I will generate some torsional vibration, torsional excitation, at the end you will have the maximum amplitude, but somewhere in the middle it will be the nodal point. And if I'll glue my zebra tape somewhere here, or I'll use multi-event wheel here, I will have the zero reading, zero response, because it will be the nodal point for this torsional vibration mode. So before any measurements, we should understand how machine is designed. And we should ask not only lateral vibration analysis from OEM, but ideally the torsional vibration analysis. Or based on geometry, based on shaft materials, we can calculate it. We can provide the rotor modeling for torsional vibration, and we can estimate how, based on shaft materials, how based on rotor geometry, it should respond. Correct? Okay. And of course, each measurements method got some advantages and disadvantages. Of course, advantages of multi-event wheel is evident. It is already installed, and we can just connect our system to get data. For zebra tape, we should glue this zebra tape to get the data. For key phasor, we have already installed probe, but it is only one signal per revolution, so frequency limitation. So all this method is discussed here, and we should understand what we can use and how we can use it. Of course, for me, I would like to use multi-event wheel or to glue zebra tape, because mainly for key phasor, the frequency range is not enough. Okay, that's about advantages and disadvantages. But for now, we have talked only about vibration, torsional excitation. We are to discuss it only frequency. But one of the important component is the twisting angle. So how big force applied to my shaft, how big is amplitude of this motion, correct? So the twisting angle is one of the important parameters. We can measure it in degrees, and in previous slides you even see the amplitude of that vibration. Of course, when we are talking about torsional vibration measurements, I should mention hardware. Hardware can be temporary installed probes, or it can be permanently installed system. For now, we have full set of temporary installed hardware, which can be temporary installed. For now, we can connect to We can connect to torque meter system. That's the special system mounted to the coupling. And you see how many parameters we can get from one torque meter system. Not only torque, which provided by that system by OEM, but we can even have the waveform of this torque. So the dynamic, let's say, shaft response for torque applied. So we can get the torsional vibration. We can see the angle, of course, and we can filter it according to our expectations. But that's not the end of the story, because for now we are at the last step of designing the special torsional vibration transducer. This transducer is installed and looking to the shaft same as proximity probe, but it is measuring not gap between shaft and probe, but it is measuring the stress inside that metal. So we can, using the, let's say, similar as proximity probe, but exactly different design probe, we can measure the stress inside the metal, so we can measure the torsional excitation response. Okay, that's about our measurement system. For now, I will finish about torsional vibration. So any questions about torsional vibration?
มีท่านใดมีคำถามไหมคะถ้าท่านใดมีคำถามสามารถถามได้นะคะทางมิสเตอร์เซอร์เจ้นะคะมีตัวแทนนะคะเดี๋ยวจะมาสรุปให้ฟังอีกทีนึงค่ะ
Yes, it is not simple, but trust me, it is easy to realize. All you need is few or even one sample or one signal per shaft revolution and software to analyze it. So let's think about it, and if you have any questions, you can contact any Bentley Wad representative, we can help. Even once or two times per year, we are providing the advanced machinery dynamic training with workshops, how to measure this vibration, how to analyze this vibration, etc., etc., about torsional. The next step will be, let's say, more easy to understand because it will be the visualization of vibration, of operation, deflection, shape. It will be more structural modeling and measurements. I selected for this case, for this conference, a simple case which done by me a few years ago, and this case is pretty interesting because customer was interested to increase the shaft speed, to increase the volume of the water injection pump, to increase the amount of oil. Of course, it was some limitation for the shaft speed, and customer wanted to reach the maximum allowed shaft speed, but it was impossible to do. And it was one more limitation. Customer allowed for us only 2 days to provide all vibration measurements, everything for 2 water flood pumps, because it was short overhaul for platform, and I got only 2 days to provide all measurements. And for me, it was only single chance, because next overhaul will be in 3 years. And if something will go wrong, I haven't any chance to repeat my measurements because my office was about 8,000 kilometers away. And in case of any logistic problem, any measurement problem, any software problem, it will be postponed for 3 years. So only one chance to provide the measurements and analyze it. Okay. Problem is pretty simple. There are 2 identical water flood pumps driven by gas turbine, through J-box main pump, J-box booster pump. Pretty simple machine and high vibration at the maximum speed. So, let's start from the beginning. Information from customer. This is pretty old unit, 25 years old. But during that 25 years, with speed less as designed, maximum allowed speed, that machine was operated more or less good. But when speed is going up, Vibration is increasing significantly. Okay. Of course, many years ago it was initially tested and everything was good. And the good case, we have monitoring and diagnostic software installed. So we have all historical data. Okay, let's see. And we can see the maximum vibration at 12,000 RPM at the gas turbine here. So at the power turbine, at the gas turbine, vibration, shaft relative vibration is pretty high for certain speed. But if speed will be dropped down from 12,000 to 10,500 RPM, you can see vibration is 3 times, 4 times lower. So, okay. Okay, I like that diagram because that diagram is a short explanation of any machinery diagnostic way. Okay, what is the problem? High vibration. What I already know, looks like it is speed or load related, because it's two things related to each other. Okay, what does it tell us? A lot. It can be imbalance, simply. It can be coupling issue, because in case of increasing speed, we increasing load, increasing vibration, coupling. Okay, structural, why not? It can be resonance anywhere, some process related. Of course, it can be. Can it be a slow roll, some scratch on the shaft? Not really, but let's think about it. And some influence from other units, why not? Okay, so do we need additional data? For sure. We decide to provide the transient vibration measurements, so startup shutdown data. Casing vibration measurements, structural measurements. Additionally, I have asked overspeed test, but customer wasn't agreed to increase vibration higher as strip level, so overspeed was skipped. Okay, so how can I get this data? Easily, I should collect data for stopped machine. I should collect slow roll data for compensation, for reference. I should increase speed to maximum allowed, till unit trip, and collect data for shutdown. Yes, during this series of measurements, which can be done during one day only for each machine, I should collect the operation deflection shape additionally, and I decided to bring some more props to measure the casing vibration. Okay, because it will be the good machine testing. Ah, one more. There is the gas turbine. There is a gas turbine, and this gas turbine has an enclosure with a firefighting system. So no chance to go inside this enclosure to measure casing vibration. So it was another story, the paperwork, how to deactivate firefighting system, how to collect the data properly at the gas turbine. Okay, so machine was stopped, then started, we operated at different speed and shut down to get all data. And situation was pretty simple, because initially the vibration was high only here, but with additional props installed at the J-box, we got the high J-box casing vibration. Now we should scratch our head and think, who is guilty? Power turbine, J-box, something else? But fortunately, we collect the transient data and see pretty simple picture. This is picture from casing vibration probe. Okay, I'll zoom it. Oh, I will not zoom it, sorry. Okay, and we can see the clear resonance signature. We can see the resonance somewhere in the structure close to the drive and side leg supports, and when I provide the operation deflect shape modeling, I have measured about 50 points with triaxial accelerometer robot for whole machine. It takes about 40 minutes to collect one series of measurements. We can see the pretty interesting machine behavior. Of course, amplitude is amplified to demonstrate, but you can see how my gas turbine is moving. Can we realize what's wrong with that machine? You can see? This legs is doing absolutely the same as my legs now doing. So support is flexible, correct? Of course, yes. And it was two types of solutions. The short-term solution was pretty simple. Dear customer, do not increase the shaft speed to operate at the safe condition, not more as 11,000 RPM. But long-term solution, at the nearest overhaul, it is necessary to increase stiffness here at the leg support to avoid that such operation. Correct? Easily. See, this is the leg support and some bin to support to make it easy to remove gas turbine. It was decided to create the much more stiffer support to avoid that motion. And after that, I asked customer, dear customer, when you will finalize this modification, I will measure vibration at your machine. And after modification, customer say, I do not need it. Why? Because based on measurements, vibration becomes close to zero. If vibration is close to zero, who care about natural frequency of that modified unit? It is already so far from natural operation speed. So the happy end was, the way to happy end was pretty simple, just to change the stiffness, to increase the stiffness and avoid operation on resonance. But to find the root cause, to find the guilty element, it was possible to, it was necessary to collect vibration from each point and visualize the vibration of like this. Okay, that's a simple example of ODS. Of course, this is simplified one. We have more complicated models. My manager even done it for huge pump, submerged pump once, but this is just to demonstrate how it is easy, because this is just visualization of vibration at the certain frequency. So it takes about 40 minutes to collect data and about 2 hours, 3 hours to build that simple model. That's all, because my time is over. Any questions, please? Two chances. Everything is clear or absolutely not clear.
มีท่านใดมีคำถามไหมคะ
One question. No. Okay. I'll be here today and tomorrow. If you're interested in any content, just ask me.
ค่ะก็ก่อนจะจบนะคะก็เดี๋ยวขอเชิญตัวแทนจากบริษัท General Electric ประเทศไทยจำกัดนะคะกล่าวสรุปนิดนึงค่ะ
สวัสดีค่ะสุดที่นี่นะคะจากเบลลี่เนวาดานะคะก็ยังไงเนี่ยทางฝนเองค่ะเป็นประจำเบลลี่เนวาดาประเทศไทยอยู่แล้วนะคะถ้าเกิดปัญหาที่เขาเสนอมาทั้งหมดอะค่ะก็คือเขาเอาเคสที่เขาเคยทำมาทั้งหมดในโลกนี้เลยนะคะเอามาแชร์เคสแต่ละอย่างเนี่ยเป็นเคสที่เราเจอแล้วยากพอสมควรเหมือนกันนะคะอย่างเคสแรกอะค่ะคือเคสทอร์ชันอลเรซูแนนซ์นะคะจริงทอร์ชันอลเนี่ยเป็นอะไรที่ตรวจเจอก็ค่อนข้างยากนะคะกว่าจะดีฟายได้ว่าปัญหาเนี้ยเป็นปัญหานี่จริงๆหรือเปล่าแล้วเราจะแก้ยังไงให้ถูกจุดนะคะตัวนี้เนี่ยถ้ายังไงใครมีคำถามหรือสงสัยว่าเครื่องจักรที่อยู่ในโรงงานนะคะหรืออยู่ในอุตสาหกรรมเข้าข่ายที่จะเป็นตำแหน่งแบบนี้หรือเป็นปัญหาแบบนี้ค่ะลองมาคุยกันได้ค่ะส่วนปัญหาที่สองค่ะก็คือเป็นจริงๆตัวนี้มันเป็นแพลตฟอร์มบนทะเลค่ะแล้วปั๊มตัวเนี้ยเขาไม่ให้เราทำอะไรด้วยเลยนะคะเราจะหายังไงเราจะแก้ปัญหากับเขายังไงเราก็ได้เอาเทคโนโลยีใหม่ๆเข้ามาเพื่อใช้หาที่มาของปัญหานั้นๆนะคะยังไงถ้าสนใจก็ลองมาคุยกันหลังไมค์ได้